Continue our school, and the next speaker, Alexander Sobolev from the English College London, about the Schrödinger paper periodic expansion.
Thank you very much. So we're going to stay with the Schrödinger operator for the rest of the morning session until lunch. I'm going to talk about periodic operators, which are slightly more general than Schrödinger, but most of the results are more convenient to state for the Schrödinger operator. And this is what I will do. So let's have a look. So what kind of periodic operators I'm going to study? Here it is, the main object. This is the polyharmonic operator. So this is minus Laplace raised to some power. And this power can be arbitrary, just positive, as long as it remains positive. Plus the potential V, it will be a real valued function. So everything will be self-adjoint. No problems with that. And I will assume, usually I'm assuming for simplicity that V is very smooth. We are not going to worry about singularities or things like that. Now, in contrast to the previous talk, in previous lecture, where V was supposed to be compactly supported, now I assume that it is periodic. Periodic with respect to some lattice gamma in a d-dimensional space. So we live in d-dimensional space. D is arbitrary, it can be one, but most interesting case is the multidimensional one. This lattice is of full rank, so it has D linearly independent lattice vectors, so it fills in the space. So this is the potential periodic with respect to this lattice. And now, let me just go very quickly through basic definitions of standard objects related to lattices. So first of all, the dual lattice, it is the lattice of which consists of vectors which I denoted by gamma w, such that their product with the initial lattice is a multiple, 2 pi multiple of an integer. For example, if you have a cubic lattice in the three-dimensional space with size 2 pi, then the dual lattice is going to be just cubic lattice of size 1. Think about this special case. This is the one that I'm going to need most of all. Now, fundamental domains, these are just factors. You can think of them in this example, the one that I just mentioned. You can think of them as tori. In the configuration space, in the space where we live, it will be torus of size 2 pi, square torus, cubic torus. And in the dual space, it's going to be the torus of size 1. So these are very simple objects. This is the leading example I'm going to use essentially all the time. But on the other hand, at some point, I will have to make a difference between two types of lattices. And the special part will be played by rational lattices. Okay, so this lattice is definitely rational in the sense of this definition. What is this definition here? We take two vectors of the lattice, take scalar product, and it should be a multiple of an integer again. The multiple doesn't depend on the choice of these vectors. Okay? So this gives us a rational lattice. This lattice is rational, definitely. Okay? When you take two vectors from the lattice, the product is always a multiple of 4 pi squared multiple of an integer. Okay? So it is a rational lattice. But it doesn't, this of course doesn't exhaust the set of all rational lattices. So rational lattices versus irrational lattices. We will come back to that later. But again, I repeat that when it doesn't matter what lattice is involved, I will almost always assume that this is the cubic lattice, just for simplicity, to avoid writing extra factors, normalizing factors. Okay. So let's see what we can do in this case. Now, this is I don't know if I need to, if I may assume that the audience is familiar with spectral theory of periodic operators, at least the basics of spectral theory of periodic operators. So I will assume that the audience is not familiar with that. So I will explain very quickly how it is done. Periodicity, the assumption of periodicity allows us to perform the so-called partial diagonalization of the operator. Right? When you want to diagonalize the operator, you want to find eigenfunctions and eigenvalues, or generalized eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. Okay? We cannot do that entirely, but we can reduce the problem to a simple one, to a simpler one. Not simple, but simpler. And this is how it is done. So here's the equation. So let me just do it in a slightly informal way. This is the spectral equation, or the Schrödinger equation, if you wish. And we're going to look for solutions of this equation in this form here. You see, so this is the function which will depend on the extra parameter k. You remember k from the previous lecture? This is a very similar one. This is not called the momentum, this is called quasi-momentum. But the meaning is essentially the same, right? So here, we extract this factor, the exponential factor, which we have already seen in the previous lecture. So it's very similar. And this function is going to be the periodic function of x. Nobody told us a priori that we can search for solutions in this form, but we're going to do that. So this is going to be our ansatz. Okay? Periodic function here times this phase function, which is not periodic, which doesn't have to be periodic. K here is a priori, initially this is just a real a vector in the Euclidean space, but we will see that we can actually restrict to a smaller set later. Now, if you take this function, this is called, by the way, the Bloch function. This is why it is called Bloch decomposition, the one that I'm going to describe now. When you take this function, substitute this in this equation, this is what you're going to get. This is the equation that you're going to get for this function, for function psi. Notice that this is now the equation for the periodic function, so the function which is defined on the torus, all right? And torus is a compact manifold, and therefore, now the problem has become a problem for the operator on the compact manifold, and therefore it will have discrete spectrum, okay? One point to emphasize here is that this operator now depends on the quasi-momentum k. So this is a family of operators that are defined on the torus, okay? And this family depends on k. And this is, well, we don't need this fact, but this is an analytic family. It's useful to remember. Now, as I said, h of k, this is operator depending on k, acts on functions defined on the torus. The spectrum is discrete, and we will do the usual thing. We will take eigenvalues, here they are, I denote them by lambda 1, lambda 2, etc. We put them in the ascending order, okay? They will all depend on k. Remember that they will depend on k, right? So there are functions of k, but we always keep them in descending order, in ascending order, so that when they intersect each other, we follow the numeration. We're very careful with that. And therefore, the only thing we can say a priori is that this function, each of those functions is going to be continuous in k. And due to the specific nature of this dependence on this parameter k, they're going to be Zt periodic. So if we extend k from the fundamental domain of this lattice outside to the entire space, we're going to get a periodic function of k. So it tells us that it suffices to study those functions on the fundamental domain to get the full information. Okay, so here's the way we find the spectrum of the initial operator. So you will ask, what do these eigenvalues mean for us? And this is what they mean. If you take the range of the function lambda j, then you're going to get something that we call spectral band. I will draw pictures in a moment. And when you take the union of spectral bands, you get the entire spectrum of this of the initial occurrence. So let me just show you very quickly a picture from the textbook how the eigenvalues behave as functions of k. So just like in the previous lecture, one-dimensional case and multi-dimensional case are very much different. Okay, let me start with the easy one, in quotes. One-dimensional case. So here, this is the fundamental domain of the dual lattice of Zd, of Z1, integers. And I will sketch graphs of those functions, lambda 1, lambda 2, etc. So in one-dimensional case, this is what these functions look like. So this is the first one. This is lambda 1. Lambda 2 will behave in a similar way, but just flipped over. Right? So this function is monotone on this half of the interval. Can you see anything from there? Monotone increasing, monotone decreasing on the second half of the interval, and it is symmetric. This function, lambda 2, is monotone decreasing first and then increasing, and also symmetric. This is an absolutely lovely picture. They are analytic, they are symmetric, everything you want. The other thing that can happen is that they can actually touch those ranges. And in this case, it is natural to think, so this is, let me just do that, lambda 3 and lambda 4, right? So this is lambda 4, this is lambda 3. But if you relabel the eigenvalues as functions of k, then this is going to be analytic. And this branch is also analytic, right? We know that. This is the specific nature of the one-dimensional case. So, back to the spectral bands. The spectral bands, by definition, so these are spectral bands of J, by definition, these are ranges of those functions. So let me draw those ranges. This is L1. L2, and then we have L3 and L4, and they are not separated by a gap. They merge, they touch. And this is all that can happen in one-dimensional case. Either they are separated or they touch. They cannot overlap. Okay. So that's the nature of the one-dimensional case. As I said, I've already mentioned this name. This is a gap, and this is a band. Okay. Now, in the multidimensional case, I will not even attempt to draw graphs in the multidimensional case, but I will show you what the bands may look like. So you have band 1, band 2, and then you may have band 3 that overlaps with band 2. And so on, and you may have plenty of bands overlapping. Okay, and when you go further up the spectrum, there will be, as you will see, more and more overlap.
But if you consider dimension 1 and A is 4, then it will be overlapping.
Say it again.
If you consider dimension 1,
yes,
and A is big enough, it will be overlapping also.
Yes. Yeah, but there will be more. Yes. That's true. I must say, thank you very much for that. I automatically assumed for this picture that L is equal to 1. I'm talking about the Schrödinger derivative. Of course, if L is large, then the number of linearly independent solutions is large, and therefore they will be overlapped. So that is the important thing. On my slides, these two letters L are different. But on the board, they may look the same. So we are not going to make any mistakes. Right, this is L equals 1 I'm talking about. what else did I want to say? Right, so what kind of questions are we going to ask now? So when you have the spectra like that, you can ask, well, once you have spectrum, you can start asking lots of questions, but I will be interested only in one. I'm interested in those overlaps. Well, because this is what I've been asked to do today by the organizers. I'm interested in these overlaps only, right? So I know that in one-dimensional case, overlaps for the Schrodinger parameter are either impossible or they just reduce just to two touching bands. This is all. In the multidimensional case, the situation is different, and I want to ask, are there any gaps at all? This is a sensible question. Maybe everything overlaps. We know that there are gaps, there are examples, but there is another question, are there any gaps starting from certain energy? So if you go far enough along the spectrum, far away, are you going to get gaps at all? And the answer that I'm going to give is that no, we're not going to get any gaps. So we're not going to get, the spectrum will fill in the whole half line starting from, let's say, from this point on. There will be no gaps at all. Now, this thing, this statement that there are no gaps is called a, let's say, it's called the Bethe-Sommerfeld conjecture. Number of gaps is finite. So meaning that starting from certain energy, there are none. Now, why short digression into history of physics. So two physicists, Bethe and Sommerfeld, studying properties of metals, conductivity of metals, right? You remember from physics courses, the standard theories, classical theories of conductivity. Consider metal as just a periodic potential. And we're looking at the electron that moves in this periodic potential. And they suggested that, they conjectured in 33 in the book on conductivity, they conjectured that from certain point there are no gaps in the spectrum. So in other words, all energy values are allowed. Okay? All energy values are allowed. And it's a nice physical conjecture, but how to prove it mathematically? So as you can see, so I gave you just a short list. Actually, the full list is not much longer. Maybe I missed a few people here, missed out. But this is essentially all that is known about this hypothesis. Yes.
This is all for
L
equal to 1, no?
All these works. No, this is a mixture. This is a mixture. If you ask me about each of these works specifically, I can tell you exactly what else you should take here. So notice that you remember in the previous lecture, we started with 1926, and then there was some progress from 1926 up to our days. Here we started 1933, and the first progress happened 60 years later, more than 60 years later. This is not an easy problem. But now, looking back, one can say that this is all clear, this is all known. But it was not easy how to approach it. So the first result was obtained by first results, I should say. You see, this is not just one result, this was a big work, big project by Skriganov in the end of 70s, beginning of the 80s. They were also co-authors here. And he concentrated on rational lattices. Right? I explained to you what rational lattices are. So this suggests that already, when I say this without going into details, this suggests that the properties of the lattice should influence the result, should have some impact on the conclusion whether or not the number of gaps is finite or not. We will see a bit later how it works. Then in 1982, Dalbert and Trubowitz, they gave a very, very easy, straightforward proof for two-dimensional case. I think I will have time for this proof. It is indeed a very straightforward one. Once you read this proof, you start asking questions. How could I not see this before? Because this is indeed about 3 or 4 pages paper. Very easy. Very elementary, I would say. Then there was a series of works by Villiers. The first one was in 87. And then there were a few in this century already. Then Karpeshina, 1990, and then there were a few afterwards as well. She could do singular potentials as well. I said that I assume that potential is smooth, but you don't have to, right? If you want to describe physical systems, you want singularities, you want Coulomb potentials. And she delivers on that for three-dimensional case. Then there was a complicated but illuminating paper by Elfer and Mohamed in 98. And they did this for 3 dimensions, 2, 3, and 4. And higher they just could not go. And you will see in a few minutes why the higher dimension goes, the more difficult it becomes. And then there was a series of papers by Parnowski and Sobolev, myself, in 2000s. And I will, some of the results I'm going to talk about are from these papers. And finally, in 2004, Skriganov and myself, we got together and we decided to review the proof, Skriganov's proof for rational lattices. Why would we want to do that? Because once you realize that lattices have an impact on the spectrum, so it would be natural to divide these two bits of the proof. The one that is relevant to the lattices, so to obtain a lattice-relevant information, and then to do the analytic part, the spectral part. This is what we did. In the initial paper, it was a little bit mixed up. Lattice part and the analytic part. Right, there are some other results on periodic domains, on graphs in dimension 2, and maybe in higher dimensions, but I'm not going to talk about them. And as far as I understand, the results are only partial. Yes?
On the paper by Hanukishina.
Yes.
So you see the singular potential, but how can you define the singular potential, periodic singular potential, periodic singular potential? How can you
define it?
Yeah.
Take a Coulomb potential centered at zero, cut it, multiply it by, I will give you just example, right? Multiply it by the smooth cutoff to the small neighborhood of zero, and then just spread it out by shifts.
So every
on every period you have a singularity, yes. It is not a localized singularity at one point, this is a periodic singularity. Okay, now, now what do we do, what are we going to do now? Let me just, so again, just to say a few words about the title. We're talking about quality and quantity. Quality is this, no gaps. This is the quality of the spectrum. Qualitative characteristics. Now, the quantity is how do we measure the fact that there are no gaps from a certain point on. Let me introduce some objects here. First of all, we introduce a standard object for the discrete spectrum. This is the counting function of discrete spectrum. So on this picture, for instance, if I take this level, lambda, and then I count all the eigenvalues below, so here I have 1, 2, 3, and at this point in the middle I have 1, 2, 3, 4 eigenvalues, okay? So this function will be a function of k, of course, this counting function, in a little bit. And then the next thing, this is the overlap multiplicity. Okay, so I count how many bands cover the given point lambda. So here, there are two. Right, there's 1, 3, 4, 3 again, and so on. So if we prove that the overlap multiplicity is positive, then we're done. Right? We have at least one band. And there is also another characteristic, a very useful one. This is the overlapped line. You see? So you take the interval which fits inside the longest band that contains lambda. Just to describe it in a bit more transparent way, let me just tell you this. So suppose that you have one band and the other here. So you have three bands, okay? These two overlap. So to find this function, what you do, you draw the graph of this function. So you draw the isosceles triangle, right, with vertices at the ends of the band. This is pi over 4. This is the graph of the function zeta. Here you do the same, although these two bands overlap. So you build two triangles on each of these bands, and then you take the maximum of these two functions. So function zeta will be this. So we are looking at the mountain range. And if this saddle point doesn't go to zero, then again you have overlap all the time. So this is what we will be looking for. So there are two characteristics: the overlap multiplicity and the overlap length. And we can say something about both of them if we make certain assumptions on the lattice. Now, how do we estimate those quantities? So M, the quantity, the overlap multiplicity is estimated by, from below, by this difference, right? You remember this function, counting function, depends on K, right? And if you take the maximal value, and then you subtract the minimal value, and if this difference is not zero, then you have an overlap. And the same, a similar formula holds for this overlap length. Well, we are not going to use it in this lecture, but it's worth writing this formula down anyway. So you shift it by t, you shift it up, you take the minimal value, and then you shift it down, you take the maximal value, and when this interval is less than the maximum here, then you take the supremum of all t that allow you to do that. Well, I'm not going to give proofs of these two statements, this inequality and this identity, but if you look at the graphs, if you look at the graphs of eigenvalues or in the pictures like that, then you will see that this is indeed the case. So the message here is that you can estimate them if you know the counting function. Okay, so that's the moral of the story. If you know the counting function, you can estimate them. Now, let me state the results now. Now the results are split, they're on the next three slides, and they are split into two groups. Results one, this is group one, and these are results that are obtained using the lattice properties. Okay. On the second slide, there will be the second group of results of that type. And on the third slide, I will just state the general result which doesn't involve lattices. And then we will just have a look and compare what's the difference between them. Now, we assume that V is infinitely differentiable, infinitely smooth, and then this is probably the only result where I need L, which is not equal to 1. Right? Otherwise, I will be talking about the Schrödinger operator only. But for this result, it is interesting to see how far you can push L, okay? Or how is L related to the dimension, the degree of the operator. The order of the operator. So, if you assume this condition, and the dimension, of course, is greater than or equal to 2, if you want any overlaps at all, then here are the estimates. So, this is the overlap multiplicity It is bounded from below by this function here. There is a factor rho, which grows when you go away along the spectrum. Rho, well, you can see that rho and lambda, they are related in a very simple way. Right? So lambda is just rho to the power 2m, the standard change of the variable here. So the multiplicity becomes large, and it grows, of course, with the dimension. But here you divide dimension by 2, right? So it's a half dimension, essentially. There is this function phi. I will talk about this function in a few seconds. You already see it, but let's not look at it now. And then there is also the overlap multiplicity, the overlap length. So look what is happening here. When you grow up, and dimension grows, so clearly that the multiplicity is non-zero. It is separated from zero. But if the dimension is large, this exponent becomes negative. Okay? For example, for the Schrödinger operator, when you have L equals 1, then for dimension 2, the overlap grows, at least the lower bound for the overlap growth is 1/2. This is for dimension 2, is this correct? 3/2, yes. For dimension 3, this is a constant overlap. And for dimension 4, we are running into trouble because the overlap is minus, is this minus a half? 5/2, 2 minus, yes, minus a half, right? So on the one hand, the multiplicity grows, so there are more and more bands covering each other, right? But on the other hand, they're overlapping only by a little bit. And the further in the spectrum you go, the smaller this overlap gets. Okay? So this indicates that if you increase the dimension, it will become more and more unstable. Right? If you switch a very small perturbation, then at least potentially what you can do, these bands that overlap just a little, there are plenty of them, but very small overlap, they can decouple, they can pull apart. Okay, and can create a gap, potentially. And so this condition tells you, for example, in the Schrödinger case, that you can use this theorem, you will get this Bethe-Sommerfeld conjecture proved for these three dimensions, 2, 3, and 4. For dimension 5, it's not going to work because of this Seeley effect. Another remark that I need to make here is that I'm stating these results as they were stated, what was that, let's say 15 years ago. There have been new developments, not in this, exactly in this problem, but in other issues related to periodic operators. And they would allow, now, they would allow to improve this condition a little bit. For example, I haven't checked it, but I think that this is true, that one can include 5 dimensions as well for the Schrödinger operator. But beyond 5, it cannot go. Okay. But, as I said, I'm going to stick to the old results. And my idea is not to report on the most advanced and the most recent results, but to tell you what kind of techniques are involved and what one can expect if one applies those techniques. Right, so this is the second theorem from the first group of the results. So here again, it's important to know the properties of the lattice. Here we're going to assume that the lattice is rational, and this is again the definition of rational lattice. Right? So we multiply two vectors, scalar product, any two vectors, stable product of two vectors, and it's going to be multiple of integer. The constant here will not depend on the choice of those vectors. This is a fixed number, real number. So this is the theorem that was essentially proved by Skrigalnov in the 80s, and then we got a new streamlined proof of that together with Skrigalnov a bit later, in 2004. So dimension is greater than or equal to 5. Let's take L to be equal to 1. So from this point on, or at least for this result, it is more convenient to talk about the Schrödinger case. Although for a polyharmonic operator, it can be done in exactly the same way. But let's not muddle the story and talk about Schrödinger case only. And the important assumption is that the lattice is rational. Once we assume that, then we get the following. For a continuous potential, it doesn't have to be smooth, it can be just continuous. We have this. There exists a point beyond which we have the following bounds for the multiplicity and for the overlap. Notice that these results, these constants do not depend, they do depend on the dimension, sorry. Of course they do. But here there is no dependence on rho. The overlap is constant. Rational lattices are very good. You do not have this funny effect when potentially the overlap goes to zero, right? So this is a stable situation. You have a constant overlap all the time. Yes?
Is that an example where this overlap actually does go to zero, or is it just because the bound is not good?
There are examples, I'm not going to talk about this, but there are examples, constructions, when you can build a potential, although this is not a local potential, this is just a periodic perturbation, which creates infinitely many gaps. Okay. But I'm not going to talk about this.
What do you mean, saying stable, unstable?
Unstable, I specified what I meant. It is by no means a formal mathematical term that I'm using here. Stable.
But you promised to talk mathematics.
Okay. I admit, yes. I promised to talk mathematics, but so I will be more careful next time. When you are in the audience. So, anyway, it is stable for a very simple reason. If you take, look at this constant overlap, imagine now you got this bound, now you have a small electric potential. You add a small periodic potential to the one that you already have. And if the size of this potential is smaller than this constant C, you're going to still have the same overlap. So now it is a precise mathematical sense.
Stability.
When it doesn't hold, this is instability. Yes?
So is it true that if your perturbation is periodic,
yes,
then L infinity norm must be at least the overlap length in order to create a gap at the given position?
At least. Yes. Well, this is a short answer. Okay. There is a long one, but I'm not going to give it. If it is periodic with the same period. Okay, so that is the lattice result. And notice that the dimension, why do we assume here d greater than or equal to 5? Because as we shall see, if you slice down, we shall see that when you look at the lattices in different dimensions, their behavior becomes more regular when you cross this threshold, dimension 5. From dimension 5 and up, the behavior of lattice points, the counting of lattice points, becomes more regular. And I will give you the result that is needed to prove this sort of theory. Now, this is the result from group 2. And this result doesn't assume anything about lattice, about the lattice. It is just, we can take any dimension starting from 2 and any parameter, any order L, positive one. And then here we have to assume that the potential is infinitely smooth. And then one can prove that the overlap from some point on is non-zero. Okay, there is a lower bound, but this bound is bad. The only positive thing about this bound is that this is positive, that the overlap is positive. But this bound, this overlap can potentially go to zero very, very fast. This parameter L can be actually very large. It depends on the smoothness of the potential, not on the smoothness, on the dimension, on some other parameters. So it is potentially very large positive parameter. So as you can see, well, there's a huge difference. First of all, of course, good news is that in this theorem we do not assume anything about the lattice, and we prove the conjecture for arbitrary potentials, infinitely smooth ones. But on the other hand, the amount of spectral information is not the same as before. You see, in the previous theorems, we could say something about multiplicity. Here, the only thing we can say that the multiplicity is at least one multiplicity of overlap. And we also said something about the overlap length. And here, we can say only this about overlap. So there are pluses and minuses. Yes?
You could estimate the quantum C.
Yes, in principle, but this is pain.
Yeah. This is my question.
What does it mean pain if you do not give any estimates for the problem?
This is what it means. I'm sorry about that too. So now, just for the sake of fairness, I should say that in fact this result doesn't have to be for the polyharmonic operator plus V. One can do, in this theorem, one can do many things. One can take an arbitrary polyharmonic operator and perturb it by an arbitrary, even pseudo differential periodic operator of degree which is just smaller than the degree of this polyharmonic operator. Right? So this is 2L, and if you take 2L minus epsilon perturbation, this is still, it still holds. The conjecture still holds. In particular, for people doing mathematical physics, if you take this operator here with periodic vector potential A and electric potential V, right? So perturbation here, A, gives you perturbation of first order. Potential zero order perturbation is the first order A, and the conjecture still holds. This follows from the theorem, from the modification, modified version of this theorem for pseudo differential operators. Okay. Now, so my, on request from the organizers, my focus today will be on the results from the first group, where lattice properties are involved. And this is easier to discuss because you can really separate these two aspects of the problem. First, we're going to do what is to do the lattice part, so to speak, or more precisely, we are going to switch the potential off. Completely forget about it and study the problem for the operator minus delta, for the Laplace operator. Okay. We're going to look at the spectrum, at the periodic spectrum, coming from this Laplace operator without any potential. And this is going to be relevant to the counting problem in analytic number theory. And then, once we obtained all the necessary results for that, for the free problem, we're going to implement some sort of perturbation theory which will allow us to switch the potentials on and get the same results. So the idea is that for the free problem, we are going to write estimates for the overlap, for the multiplicity of the overlap, and for the length of the overlap, and then hope that the overlaps will be sufficiently large so that when you switch the potential on, they are not going to pull apart the bands. So that's the philosophy. Okay? So it is truly a sort of perturbation theory. Okay, let's start with lattice point count. Now, why am I counting lattice points here? Because, so let's start from the beginning. So the lattice for this, for the beginning of this slide, it is sufficient to look at the cubic lattice, right, of size 2π. So that the dual lattice is just Zd, the cubic Zd. And we also look only at the Schrödinger case. Although, as I said before, if you take L greater than zero, just arbitrary L, everything goes through in the same way. Just for simplicity. Now, if V is equal to zero, so what can we say about the eigenvalues? You remember, this is an easy, straightforward conclusion, right? So this is your operator, depending on K. So you might ask, why do we need to do anything for the free case? This is just Laplace. Everything is known about Laplace. But we want to put Laplace operator in the context of periodic problems. So we're going to look at this operator on the torus, okay, and see what it will give us. So this is the free operator of the torus, depending on K. And, well, the eigenvalues are given by these numbers. Eigenfunctions are exponentials. Everything is straightforward. You can compute eigenvalues. And these eigenvalues are parameterized by lattice points. For every lattice point, you have an eigenvalue. Of course, it is very good news that we have eigenvalues explicitly. So what is the problem? Because these eigenvalues are not labeled. Once you start labeling them, this is where the problem starts. You remember, we want to arrange them in the ascending order. So try to arrange those numbers in ascending order where M is from Zd. That is a difficult problem. And then let's talk about counting function instead. And here is the counting function of those eigenvalues. We'll look at all eigenvalues that are less than or equal to rho squared. You remember the definition of the counting function. And in other words, we are looking at all the lattice points. We're counting all lattice points that satisfy this inequality. We can interpret this in a different way. Again, look, we have, so we are looking at all lattice points that are inside the ball of radius rho, centered at the point minus k. Right? You can visualize that. You have a lattice, you have a ball of radius rho, and you're moving it. When k moves, you move the ball. And the number of points inside the ball, of course, will depend on the center, on the position of the center. And then, a few things that we can say about this counting function. First of all, let's take the mean value. We're going to integrate in k. This is a very useful observation. We are going to integrate this in k over the fundamental domain of the dual lattice. So it will be like that. So you have a lattice, you have k, this is the fundamental domain of the lattice, and you move k within this fundamental domain, count the lattice points that get in that ball of radius rho, and then in that line when we take the mean value, we integrate over this domain, take the average value. And what it gives us? It gives us the volume of the ball. This is a straightforward calculation. It is not even an exercise. Okay? The main of the ball. So, the volume of the ball. This is the factor that contains gamma function and so on, so I don't need to write it down. Right, so what do we do now? What was the idea? You remember the formula? I will go back a bit. Here. You remember this formula. So you take the maximal value of the counting function, subtract the minimal value, and this will give us a lower bound for the multiplicity. So we need to be able to catch those minimal and maximal values. Right? In other words, let's start doing this by looking at this deviation of the number of points inside the ball from the mean value, from the volume. And once you write this formula, once you write this definition of this function r, you immediately, well, sorry, this has to be rho squared. I missed that. You immediately realize that now we are dealing with the classical circle problem, so-called circle problem, estimating the deviation from the volume, deviation of number of points inside the ball, or inside the circle if we're talking about the plane, right, from the volume of the ball. And this is a very, very classical problem. Here are just a few names of people involved in this business from Gauss, and slightly less than 200 years, is it? No, more than 200 years. Then Landau, this is Edmund Landau, beginning of the 20th century. Jarnik, Klafka, this is before the war. And then Kretzer and Novak, these are 60s, 70s. And Axel and Goetzen, our contemporaries. They were all involved in estimating this quantity in different situations, in different terms. In particular, I will need only one result, but I mentioned a bit more. So this bound is a classic, sorry about that. This bound is a classical one. It is a bound obtained by Landau in 1914. So here, you see d minus 2 plus kappa. And kappa is no negative number. I can write this kappa down. But what is so nice about this bound? If you look at this lattice points inside the ball, right? So what would be the kind of intuitive, straightforward conclusion? So if we know that the bulk of the lattice points is described by the volume, then it would be natural to say that the correction to the volume will be the surface area. Right? So if the volume is of order rho to power d, then the surface area is of order rho d minus 1. And this is wrong, because the ball is a convex, sorry, the sphere is a convex set. In this case, we can write a better estimate, and this is a better one. And this kappa is, I will write this down, kappa is 2 over d plus 1. So it becomes smaller if dimension grows. This proof, it can be given as an exercise for, I'm thinking about the year, second or third. Maybe not first year. But this is a very straightforward estimate. Now it is straightforward. Then it was very new and exciting. So it becomes very close to d minus 2. And in fact, if you use more advanced methods, just like Goetze did in 2000, you can obtain the following bounds for higher dimensional case when d is greater than or equal to 5. You can obtain just rho d minus 2. So when you cross this borderline d equals 5, you get more regular behavior of in the circle problem. And another thing to mention here, that if your lattice is irrational means not Russian, then you get O small. And there are examples when you can estimate it even better, but I'm not talking about those examples. So these are known results, relatively recent results on lattice counting, providing upper bounds, and I should say uniform upper bounds, uniform in K, upper bounds in the circle problem. Now, going back to our problem, you remember what we need. These upper bounds are not going to be enough for us because we need lower bounds. We need to measure the variation between the maximum number of points inside the ball and the minimum number of points inside the ball. This is where the problem lies. And these bounds do not give it. They're uniform to begin with, and they're upper bounds. Okay. So we need to do something else. So, and here is what we will be doing. Now, this is theory, again, Spirganov's theorem from the 80s, slightly improved in 2004. Let's take a rational lattice and assume that d is greater than or equal to 5. We already remember that there is a good upper bound, rho to d minus 2, Goethe's bound from the previous slide. And believe it or not, that the if you take the maximal value of this thing, of this deviation, it will be bounded from below by the same bound. So this is the precise bound. And in this case, you can write precisely what this constant is. Now you asked about the constant.
No.
You asked me about a different constant. No, you don't okay. Avoid that. Anyway.
I swear.
So what is the idea here? This is, I would like to...
Maximum would be just a fluke.
Sorry?
Maximum, just a fluke.
That's enough. It could be just a fluke, as you say. And it is, in fact. That's enough. So I would like to stop here for a while and to talk a bit about the ideas involved here. So d greater than or equal to 5. So what is the problem that we are going to mention now is this. How many squares do you need to represent an arbitrary integer number, positive integer number? Right? Positive integer number, we know that, is always the sum of 4 squares. It is always the sum of 5 squares. If you have 5, you can always represent it as a sum of 5 squares. In a non-trivial way, I mean, you can take 0, of course, when you have 4, but this is not good enough. So starting from dimension 5, you have a very regular description of that property, and this is that description. So first of all, for any positive number n, for any positive integer n, you can always find lattice points in Zd under this condition, such that their length squared would be equal to n. It is the same that I said, that you need d numbers squared to represent number n. This is the same story. Okay. Or in other words, if you have a sphere of radius square root of n, you will always have lattice points on that square, on that sphere. So this is another way of saying the same thing. Now, the question is, how many points are on that sphere? And the number of these points, this is the number of points in that sphere, is bounded from below and above by these numbers. So it is radius of the sphere power d minus 2, radius of the sphere to power d minus 2, from below and from above.
What is known about the constants?
There is the asymptotic expansion. This is
the uniform constant.
These are uniform constants.
But what is known about them? Not asymptotically.
This I cannot answer this question. But there is a formula. I guess that if you go back to the method, to the proof of this asymptotic formula, then you could probably extract something about those constants. They are given in terms of some arithmetic functions. I'm afraid I won't be able to reproduce that now. And this is why we need d greater than or equal to 5, because if you have 4 squares, the four-dimensional case, then you do not have the lower bound for the number of points on the sphere. There are some freaky cases when the number of representations falls down for four-dimensional case. case. But for five-dimensional, this is very regular, as you can see, starting from dimension 5. And they are, the important thing is that they're distributed uniformly over the sphere. Right? So in other words, if you take a spherical cap with some fixed opening angle, take a cone, right, centered at the origin, and then this cone cuts out a spherical cap on the sphere, and there will be the number of points on that cap will be the lattice point. It will be bounded from above and from below by the same powers of radius, right, with some constants depending on the opening angle. So that's a convenient property too. We're going to use. Okay. Now, I do want to, even if I have no time later to finish the proof, I want to mention this wonderful method that Skrigano suggested, which is he called the empty shell method. It's a, I think it's a very clever one. So remind you again that what we want to take a ball centered at minus k. We're going to move it around and see whether we can catch the maximum number of points, as many as we can, or we can move it again to ensure that there is a minimal number of points inside. So this is the method that allows to do that. And it is based on the following straightforward, not straightforward, but elementary observation. So look at the sphere. Okay, let's take this sphere inside here. So we're looking at two concentric spheres. One of them is of radius square root of m. So this sphere, you see, it will contain lattice points. And then I'm increasing the volume, and because this is a rational lattice, I know it is not even rational, this is, we're talking the lattice Zd, right? Let's talk about Zd. This would be enough. And when we increase the radius, there will be some empty space, there won't be any lattice points until we hit square root of n plus 1, right? So there's the sphere of radius square root of n, square root n plus 1, and between there are no points. This is empty shell. This is why it is called empty shell. Now, I'm going to take another sphere, and this is the one that we are moving around. We're trying to catch in that sphere the lattice point. I'm going to take this another sphere. Initially, I will center it at the same point, at zero, so they will be all concentric. So this yellow sphere contains as many points as the one inside. Right? Now, I'm going to move it around. So one of two things might happen when I'm moving it around. Let me draw those features. So we still have the outside sphere on that one. And then we'll need another picture as well. So what can happen is that while I'm moving it, let's say, this way, okay, this sphere will touch the interior sphere without reaching the outer sphere. This is option one. Option two, the outer sphere will be intersected without touching the inner sphere. This is doesn't look like a sphere, without touching the inner sphere. Oh, wait a minute, here I also need the intersection, sorry. I need the intersection. So here, we are interacting with the inner sphere, and here we're interacting with the outer one. So, while we are moving the sphere, the yellow sphere, just a little bit, we still keep the same number of points as in the inner sphere. Once we intersected it, we lost all these points. Right? How many did we lose? That many. Right? You remember the uniform distribution. So we lost exactly this many points. Radius to power d minus 2 with a constant. Now, in this case, the opposite effect happens. Once we cross the outer sphere, we get new points inside. Again, how many we can extract from this information. Radius to power d minus 2. Well, this is just...
Sorry, what areas of this is this
Yes, they are involved. Yes. So the details, technical details of the proof, of course, involve the proof that this opening angle is large. So we do have that many points there. It is separate, well separated from zero, of course. If it were only a tiny cap, we wouldn't be able to say that. But the angle is large, indeed. So, so that's the essence of the method, and it allows us to show that estimate. Technical details are quite involved and implemented.
But where is in this situation that dimension is big enough? Where? Because for me, all the pictures, dimension is absent.
Well, if you take a two-dimensional case, lattice points are not distributed uniformly. You don't know how many lattice points you have here. You may not have them at all, because not every integer is represented as a set of two squares. Yeah.
But you can rotate, right? You can choose those directions in some optimal way.
Yes, you can, yes. So I invite you to do that. Well, I think that the main problem is that not every integer is represented as a sum of two squares. I'm almost sure that there can be some modifications or something. The thing is that if dimension is small, and if we are concentrating on better zomorphism, we do not need all that. It is much easier, straightforward. Okay, so that's the wonderful method that I like very much. Very simple consideration, right? Empty shell. You just move around, and you do it by hand. Right? Move it, count the points, estimate is done. So let's go to the next. Right, lower bounds again, we need lower bounds, right? So lower bounds, but arbitrary lattices. Now here, it turns out that the useful thing is to study LP norms of the deviation. So far we were looking at the L infinity norms, the maximal value of the function. Of the deviation R. And now let's look at LP. The first bound, this is the upper bound for S2, L2 norm. This is indeed very straightforward. It is easy to prove indeed. How do we do that? We find, because we are in the lattice counting problem, we don't have some complicated counting function of some unknown periodic operator. We are counting lattice points, so we can find all Fourier coefficients of this function R explicitly. And then you square them, you use this Percival's formula. You square them, sum them up, and you get this essentially after a few lines of calculations. We will do this, we will not do this estimate, but we will calculate Fourier coefficients of this R on the next slide, or maybe two slides later. A few slides later. But again, the lower bound, this is a pain, and here is the lower bound. The first theorem is, suppose that D is not 1 modulo 4, then we have the lower bound of the same type. This is for S1, but if you have this bound for S2, therefore you have lower and upper bound for all P's between 1 and 2. And so this is the same sort of lower bound for these values of dimensions. And remarkably, if you drop this condition, if you assume that, for instance, you concentrate on the other case, on the opposite case, when D is equal to 1 modulo 4, then there will be some funny effects. This is something that has not been known, and I can speak out for myself. We obtained a lower bound, in this case, for S1. Look, it has the same rho d minus 1 over 2 power, okay. rho d minus 1 over 2, but it also has this funny factor containing double logarithm. To power 4. The question is, of course, how precise is that? Is the sharp? It is pretty sharp. As this upper bound shows, that if you are interested in the upper bound, that what happens that you can find the sequence of radii such that on these radii, this function S1 will satisfy this upper bound here. The same power of rho and also double logarithm the exponential, but to power 1. So it is not exactly absolutely sharp, but quite close. So this shows that this lower bound is not just because we don't know how to get the right bound here. This is something which is related to the nature of lattices. So for these dimensions, this is something funny happens. And remarkably, I will show you a bit later if I have time, it is absolutely clear where this condition becomes important in the proof of this fact, or that fact. You will see in a few slides. Right, so this is the lower bound, and then, so not in a few slides, just now, right now, I'm going to do that. So, as I promised, we're going to calculate the Fourier transform of the counting function. This is a very elementary proof here. There is no complicated technique involved, just Fourier transforms and nothing else. So we have a function, a counting function, which I just denote by f of k for the sake of brevity. Not to drag with me all the time this complicated notation. Rho is fixed for the time being. Now, Fourier transform of this function, more precisely Fourier coefficient of this function. Right? So this is the, if we are in ZD case, this is just a unit cube. We integrate over the unit cube. And then, f of k, you see this is the counting function, so you can convert this integration over the unit cube into integration over the ball of radius rho. So here, you just have Fourier transform, the indicator of the ball of radius rho. This is just exercise, it's a very, very simple exercise. And when gamma is equal to zero, you just get the ball. Right? You remember the mean value of the counting function. If gamma equals zero, you get the value. If gamma is not zero, so let's do it like that. Each of these Fourier transforms, so let's start from the right-hand side of the formula. So this Fourier transform at point gamma, it is bounded from above by this integral. Right? So if you take this Fourier transform, and you estimate the Fourier coefficient here, you can just write the modulus of this function here. This is a very rough estimate, modulus of the function. Or, alternatively, you can take this function and subtract any constant you want, and the estimate will still hold if gamma is not zero. And this is what I did here. So this Fourier transform is bounded by this integral, but I will also take Fourier transform at the double point, that's the one, and it is also bounded by the same integral, hence I have factor 2 on the left hand side. And by definition, this number sigma 1, I made a mistake. This is not sigma 1, this is S1. Right? This is L1 norm of the deviation. So I'm sorry about that. This creeps in from other papers. Notation different. So this is S1 here. So S1 is bounded from above by the sum of two from your coefficients, some points arbitrarily chosen points gamma. Now, why do I need 2 points? Why can't I have just one? Let me explain that. Why do I need 2 Fourier coefficients? This is the precise formula for the Fourier coefficient. When you do this, I mean, this is a very straightforward exercise. You get, of course, Bessel function here, and you get some powers of rho and gamma. Right? And gamma here, you cannot, might not see it, but this gamma is not bold face. This is just a positive number. Okay, so this is positive number, length of gamma. Now, if I want to estimate from below this Fourier coefficient, take the modulus of this coefficient, estimate it from below. We know that this function is going to have zeros, Bessel function. So inevitably, the Fourier coefficient will vanish at some point. Vanish or will be too small. The trick is to add 2 of those coefficients and to ensure that the roots fall into different places, okay, so that they will be always separated from zero. And this is exactly what happens here. This is the formula that we need. So if we add these 2 functions, Bessel functions, they will be always bounded by the same, by z minus half, like 1 over square root of z, for large z, of course, assuming that this condition is satisfied. Mu, I repeat, is d over 2. So this condition is exactly d is not equal to 1 modulo 4. This is exactly that condition. And once you got this estimate, assume that we got it. I will explain how to get it on the next slide. This is even more elementary calculation. So once you got this estimate, you substitute it in this bound here, and you get exactly what we want. You get rho to power d minus 1 over 2. Right? You have rho d minus d over 2, and here you get another rho minus half, and this is rho d minus 1 over 2. And that's it. That's what we want. Now, how do we get? So here is the condition. Here is the condition that is going to be important. How do we do that? So let's write down the asymptotics of the Bessel function. This is it. And the g is just sine. We are not interested in the remainder term. It is too small for us. We will try to beat the remainder term. And now let's look at this sine. And a is just that. Now, if you look at sine of at this function of z and at 2z, and look at the roots of those sines, and here they are, you write them explicitly, right? These are the roots. And if this number, a, is not integer, then the roots are separated all the time. And if they're separated, then the sum of the moduli of these 2 functions is always separated from 0. So this is the condition where this is the point where the condition or the dimension becomes important. And because the proof is so elementary, one begins to think that there must be some, if this is so elementary, there must be some clever trick which allows you to avoid that, right? And get the same bound. Maybe to use a different argument or something like that. And as I explained before, it turns out that there is no clever trick, that this difference between these 2 cases is actually, it does take place, this effect. So S1 can grow much slower for those dimensions when d is equal to 1 modulo 4, at dimension 5, for instance. It can grow much slower than in the other dimensions. Okay. Now, do I have 15 minutes? Okay, now perturbation theory. This is the, I assume that we've done with the largest point consideration, so we did everything for the free case, and now we're going to perturb the free case. All these estimates that we have in the free case are going to be perturbed by switching on the electric potential. And here how it is done. So first of all, this is a straightforward, again, this is very elementary. I am essentially explaining to you how Dahlberg and Trubovitz did their proof for two-dimensional case on 3 or 4 pages. So this is the observation about just arbitrary function that satisfies this condition. So the average value is 0. And then this is what you can derive. Because the average value is 0, the maximum of this function is positive, and the minimum or supremum is positive, and the minimum is negative, unless the function is 0, of course. So you can estimate the supremum from below by the integral, and the infimum from above by the same integral, okay, for the modulus with the minus sign. Straightforward. And therefore, once you remember that we had this sort of bounds, lower bounds for, I'm writing them explicitly here, rho squared k minus the volume of the ball. Satisfies the lower bounds r minus 1 over 2 times phi. And phi is that phi function that has this double logarithm. Not writing it fully, just with phi. Right? This is the lower bound. So I'm going to use these estimates for the lower bound. For that function f, which is there on the integral. And it gives me immediately these two bounds. Maximum number of eigenvalues, the free eigenvalues, or maximum number of points, bounded by volume plus this lower bound. And minimum number is well separated. It satisfies the upper bound with the minus sign. So they are separated. And then this gives me the lower bound for the unperturbed case, the lower bound for the multiplicity of overlapping, and lower bound for the overlap length in the free case for the Laplace operator for L equals 1. You see here there is no L, here it is 3 minus d over 2, L equals 1. Okay. Now, if the dimension is 2, we don't need to do anything else because the overlap here is 3 minus 2 over 2. It is rho 1 half, as I explained in the beginning. The overlap is very large. It grows if we go along the spectrum, far away. And if the overlap is grows, if we switch a bounded potential on, it's not going to do anything with the spectrum. There will be still overlap. So this is it. This is the proof of Trubovitz and Dahlberg. And in two dimensions, they don't have to think about five-dimensional formula with double logarithm. They just need a very simple lower bound, just obtained specifically for two dimensions, straight away. So this is what they did on 4 pages and provided a proof. That was an amazing proof. Right, what do we do for higher dimensions? For higher dimensions, we need something else. We need some exterior input. And this input is this. If you, this is the result due to Cartesian, which is in 2000 or something, 2001, I think. For all dimensions starting from 2, L is here as well, you can see that. 2L is greater than 1. Now it is not only, actually, let me just talk about one-dimensional case. I have R squared here. Not one-dimensional case. L equals 1, Schrödinger operator. Forget about this L here. Now, we have that. And then the bound that she proves is this, that the L1 norm of the proper counting function together with the potential is very well approximated by the free one. You take L1 norm, that's what the integral difference of the counting function and the free counting function, and then it will be bounded by this d minus 3 times log. This is not the precise bound, but it is a very good bound because it has d minus 3. It is not d minus 2, which would be a straightforward estimate. It is something that improves on that. In fact, today we know that there shouldn't be any log, and this 3 should be equal to 4. That's what it is. But I will continue as if I didn't know anything about that. So this is d minus 3. And then, of course, from this result, you can immediately say that the mean values are also estimated by the same number, the mean values of those functions, counting functions. So this is the input that we need. And here's the proof. And the proof is, yes, almost one slide and nothing else. So what we do here is this. What do we want to estimate? We want to estimate this L1 norm. Do you remember I did this two slides ago for the free case? This is what I did for the free case. I was looking at the deviation of the counting function from its mean value in the free case. On this slide, I'm looking at the deviation of the full counting function together with the potential from its mean value. And I'm looking at L1 norm again. So this is something that I want to estimate from below. And here I have that integral, I have that L1 norm that we had on the previous slide. Full function minus unperturbed function. Right? Here it is. So this is T of rho, the notation, just shortcut notation. Now let me just do a few straightforward estimates. So what I will do, I will take S, I will insert in that L1 norm unperturbed function and its mean value. And then I will just estimate it like that. I will keep the free function here as the main term, but the difference between the full and perturbed, I will include in the estimate is the minus sign. So here we go. This is the error that we make if we replace m by m naught. So that's the error that we make. And we know from the previous slide that both these terms, first of all, this is T of rho itself, and this is also bounded by T of rho. So we have that bound. And sigma 1 again, I'm sorry, it is S1. This is just that L1 norm, the one that we have estimated from above. Oh, sorry, from below. From below, that's the important bit. Okay, now, as we did exactly in the same way as we did for the unperturbed case, I'm going now to get the maximal value of this counting function, right? So this is, as I did for the free case, maximal value of this counting function will be bounded from below by the mean value plus S of S here, right? And then I add and subtract terms in a convenient way so that eventually I arrive at the unperturbed counting function only, and its difference from the full function. And this is the bound. For this function, we know quite a lot, right? So this is just the volume. And here it is. And here I have S, and here I have T. This is minus T. Okay, so this is the maximum of the counting function estimated from below like that. And now, S is estimated from below by these guys, and I will use this estimate here. So I got S1, this is lowercase s, not sigma 1, S1, minus 3t. And in the same way, I can write the upper bound. Exactly as I said, as in the free case, the upper bound for the minimum of this counting function And it is very similar one, except that here I subtract S1 plus 3t. So here I have plus sigma plus S1 minus 3t minus S1 plus 3t. Now, what I want from these two, maximum and minimum value, I want them to be separated. And to separate them, I take the maximum, subtract the minimum, and I get this bound for it. So clearly, to separate them, this term should be dominating. This one is a bad term. It can make it negative. This one is always positive. For S1, I have this bound, and then writing it here. And for t, I have the bound from Cartesian's theorem. You remember, rho d minus 3 times log. Now, what remains to do is to compare these two terms. Which term is larger? And this one is going to be larger if dimension is 2, 3, 4. And from 5 on, it doesn't tell us anything at all, anything useful. So this completes the proof, essentially. No, this is the next one. What I wanted to say that if we know that there's a bound d minus 4 now, here instead of d minus 3, then you can push it all the way to dimension 5, I suppose. 5 minus 1 over 2 is 2, and 5 minus 3, 5 minus 4 is 1. Yes, it does push it to dimension 5. So, but once you know the method, you can now produce, you know, old versions of that is a different conjecture. Anything we want to do. One more remark I wanted to make. Notice that this is the usual unpleasant situation that happens in this business, that here you have d minus 1 over 2, and here you do not divide dimension by 2. And this is why you can go only this far, right? To dimension 4 or to dimension 5 if you use the intuitive result. On the other hand, if you have the rational lattices, then you remember the power there was d minus 2. And when you don't divide the d by anything else, then you can go all the way to infinity. You can increase dimension. And I think it is absolutely perfect timing for me to stop. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the nice lecture, and I'm sorry for pain.
Yes.
And there are some questions for remarks. Keep in mind.